Guys, it's just great to have you here. I'm so blessed to be able to open this time up to you. JP was brought in for chapel for our students yesterday. He did a big question and answer time last night. We had a few hundred here sitting in the chapel style of this auditorium. And then he'll be with us tomorrow with chapel as well for our students. And so we have been blessed by this man already. I know you will also. But let me give you a quick, let me tell you first, we threw a few blank pieces of paper on the table too, because you're going to want to take some notes. If you didn't bring some notepad with you or iPad, some way to take some notes, there's some blank paper there. Feel free to keep the pen if you'd like, take it home with you. And so that's why the items are on the table, they're for your use. If you should need the restrooms or something during this time, I hope you can hang in there till about 10:30. We're going to take a break at 10:30 and be right out those doors to your left in the blue building where the elevator is. That's where you'll find the restrooms. The juice and coffee and fruit will be available to you all morning, so please continue to help yourself to it. In just a moment, I'm going to have Dr. John Jackson come up, our president. I think he's in his about fourth year. And doing a fantastic job, guys. We are moving so quickly, as you've seen by the drive-in, with all that construction. I'm going to let him tell you about that, give some of his vision of what's happening here at the university, that we're so excited to run alongside him for what God has called us to do with over 1,200 students now. And it has really been a blessing. So John will then pass it on to Brad Swope. He's a pastor in the area who's teaching with us part-time, and he has taken a class currently from JP. And so that's how we were able to get a hold of Dr. Moreland to bring him up this direction. He'll introduce JP, and we'll have a wonderful morning together. Can we start with prayer? Father, thank you. What a joy to be together as these leaders join in hearing from one of these great men of faith, Dr. Moreland. We thank you for his life, for what he has brought to the kingdom, for the way he has helped us clearly think and reason our faith. And we pray, Lord, that this morning you'd be with him. We thank you for the people who sit right across the table from each of us here this morning, for the ministries that they have, the towns that they come from, and the people that they influence. God, would you continue to bless them? Would you continue to strengthen them, help them not to grow weary in this very important task that they have in shepherding, in leading, in preaching your word. So, Father, we give you the praise for all that you have done and will do, and we thank you for being with us this morning. In your son's name, amen. Dr. Jackson?
Thanks, Jim. I will tell you just a little bit about Jessup in a few moments, but before I do, let me just say a little bit about you. This whole church partnership thing, the way I communicate it, the way I sell it when I'm out on the stump is, how many of you know that pastors and church leaders could stand to be heroes every once in a while to the people in the church? You're not always considered heroes, right? Occasionally, people don't think you're all that in a bag of chips. So if you want to be a hero to people in your church, here's a great thing to do. Jessup has scholarship money, and we're going to use that scholarship money. There is no group of people that I would rather us use our scholarship money on than men and women, young men and young women from your churches. And so here's what we do. Essentially, when people become partner churches, then what we do is we automatically have a church partnership grant of $2,000 to $8,000 per year. And if it's a four-year student, that means every single year they get $2,000 to $8,000 to come to Jessup. I think the number last year was about $800,000 plus that we gave in that kind of scholarship. So for your church supporting Jessup, the students from your church end up getting that support. And many churches who don't even have students who are coming at this time, they give into that because they know even if it's not present, it might be future, and they're sowing into young men and young women who are coming out of our churches. So that's just kind of our deal on that. As Jim said, really right there at the core of our mission statement is in partnership with the church. I say all the time that I'm an unrepentant fan. An unrepentant fan. There are many things I need to repent of, but this is not one of them. I'm an unrepentant fan of the local church. You folks are the heroes. We want to partner with you. In fact, sometimes I say, much to the annoyance of some in our community, that Jessup is a child of the church. We're a child of the church. We were birthed out of the church. Now, you need to hear me say, we're an adult child of the church. And if any of you have adult children, you know occasionally they talk back. I'm shocked at what my adult children now understand about my parenting skills that they didn't understand when they were preteens and teens. But it's a good conversation. So we are a child of the church at Jessup University. We're an adult child, so we need to be in meaningful conversation with the church. Many times you will challenge us, And many times we will challenge you, and it's a great partnership. That's why those words are so sacred to us almost, in partnership with the church. Well, thanks for being here at Jessup. As Jim said, you are on the campus. You are in our house, and we've got some dirt flying. And I was going to apologize, but I thought, no, I don't need to apologize. I'm actually going to explain to you what's happening and not apologize for the dirt. We've got some great things happening. It's an indication of, I think, the hand of God, His favor on us. We're in just a really unique season. I'll talk about that in just a moment. But in terms of construction, you see a building up in front, just as you came in off of Sunset. You see a bunch of tractors. You see the building being torn down. That is not because we made a mistake in construction. That is because we are literally tearing it down to the foundation. We'll be digging up the foundation because we're going to replace that portion of that warehouse, which used to be where Herman Miller Furniture Company manufactured their fine and executive office furniture. This was the assembly warehouse. And then back out where our new gym and dining facility is, used to be the shipping bay, 26 shipping bays. Well, that section that's being torn down is being torn down because we have to redo the foundation, dig deeper into the earth, because we have a three-story dorm that's going to be rising there. 210 students will be able to be accommodated in that dorm. That's a really exciting thing. We have had 80 students in a residential hotel about a mile from the campus for the last 3 years. We've been full every single year with 80 students, and this last year, because of our growth, we had 92 students who we just said, I'm sorry, we can't accommodate you on campus, and we can't accommodate you off campus. You have to figure out your own housing. Now, we did the best we could, but if you've ever had the situation as a pastor of saying, you know, we can't take any more children in this room, the children's ministry is being overrun, you know, the inmates have taken over the asylum, and you say, you can't take anymore. That's what it's been like the last 3 years, and particularly the last year where we just couldn't accommodate. So we're going to bring 210 students home. There's a demand for that. We want to meet that, and thanks be to God for faithful donors and our board of trustees who've made it possible for us to move forward with that construction. We're very excited about that. Now, there's a large road project that's happening. You see that road being built. If you go on the back part of our campus along the way to Whitney High School, there's a road that will go from Whitney High School, that road there, Wildcat Way, all the way through to Sunset Boulevard. That will be called University Avenue. It'll essentially bisect our campus. We don't have our address yet. Our new address will be University Avenue, not Sunset Boulevard. We're lobbying for a number of things. We're saying we'd like to either be one University Avenue or 1000 University Avenue, or we have had somebody lobby for 1939 University Avenue, because that was the date when our university was founded as San Jose Bible College back in 1939. We're not sure. These things are in the hands of the post office. So we're lobbying, and we'll just see what they decide, whenever they decide. So that road's being built. By the way, eventually there will be a road called Placer Parkway that will go from 65 here all the way over to 99. And it will be a boulevard that is in between Sunset and Twin Oaks. So if you're familiar with 65, between Sunset and Twin Oaks will be a road. Whitney Boulevard will be the name, and it will begin the Placer Parkway, which will mean that from Jessup to the airport, which should be about a 25-minute drive at the most. We're very excited about that. We think that's just another indication of how the Lord is blessing and how the Lord's favor is upon Jessup, is that we are located in an area where God just seems to be doing a number of things. We are in a season of growth, and so let me just share with you again the hand of God. We have record enrollments. We're actually now closer to 1,400 students. This coming fall will be well over 1,000 traditional undergraduates. We'll have 300 to 400 adult degree completion. Those are typically nighttime students. You may not know that we not only have nighttime classes on this campus in Rockland, but we have a San Jose location. And I'm really committed. We have 65 years of our heritage tied up in the Bay Area. We moved here 10 years ago. This is our 75th year anniversary. I'm really committed that we need to have a long-term presence in the Bay Area. The Bay Area is the center of innovation and technology and venture capital. So we have one center there. We'll ultimately have two or three. I also believe it was the hand of God that brought us to the capital region. This campus is 18 miles from the state capital of the largest state in the nation. And for good and for ill, as goes California, so goes the nation. And as goes the nation, so goes the world. Christ-centered higher education absolutely needs a vibrant, dynamic, biblically grounded university in this region. Three things I say to people all the time is that Jesus is the Lord, so the Lordship of Christ, the authority of Scripture, and the unity of the church. We have a John 17 kind of calling over our ministry here at Jessup, and I'm so grateful for your partnership in that. Let's not have any fights break out, but there actually are some Calvinists in the room, and there's some Arminians. There's some cessationists in the room, and there's some continuationists in the room. There's some high church folks in the room and some low church folks in the room. There's some steeple and stained glass folks, and there's some warehouse people. There's some big church and some small church. The panorama of the body of Christ is living under a John 17 calling that I think that the Lord is making known. And Jessup is a safe place. And because of Bryce Jessup and Jim Jessup and the family of the Jessup community, I think that's part of the assignment that we consider a sacred trust here at William Jessup University. You may not know this, and I'll close with this. You may not know this, but the programs at Jessup are expanding dramatically. In the last several years, we've added a math major. We've added a Middle Eastern studies minor. We have a biology major, a creative arts major, a kinesiology major. We're adding, ultimately, allied health. So the sciences are growing like crazy. We're adding environmental science coming up this fall. Computer science is happening. And ultimately, as God begins to work, our vision is to partner with you to equip transformational leaders for the glory of God. If you're familiar with the whole concept of seven mountains, we want to equip transformational leaders and release them into society. Some of them will be church leaders. Our number two major here at Jessup is Bible, theology, and ministry. If you take all those degrees together, that's our number two major here at Jessup. And I believe that ultimately God wants us to equip not only people for the church, but to equip them for the classroom, for the marketplace, for healthcare, for government, for arts, media, and entertainment. We're so grateful for our partnership with you. We want to thank you for who you are. And a great example of that is our partnership with Brad Swope. Brad is a local church pastor. He loves Jesus, and he leads effectively a local church ministry. And he's one of our adjunct faculty members, teaches one of our key classes, and is pursuing doctoral studies. And in that context is where he's been interacting with J.P. Moreland. J.P. is a great gift to the body of Christ, a gift to me personally, and a gift to my family. My second daughter, Dina, got her master's degree in apologetics and studied with JP. And just we would have glorious conversations when she would be in his classes and she would study the materials and think about the interactions. So I want to give a more complete introduction by introducing Brad Swope to you. Will you welcome Brad Swope to the platform?
Yeah, I tell my church that when I complete my doctorate, because my name is Brad Swope, I will actually be Dr. BS. And that's what they're going to be welcome to call me Dr. BS from that point. In our last cohort, in our residency, Dr. Moreland said something that struck me that I want to share with you. This was his first time with us at this residency, and he sat down, and it wasn't time for a lecture. He wanted to communicate an idea with us. And he looked at us in the eye, person to person. In the rooms, about 20 people, very gifted, educated, erudite, good thinkers. And he said, I want you to start thinking of yourself as Christian intellectuals. And he let it just sit. And you could tell, or across the room, it was a brand new idea. That these very educated, capable, reasoned, thoughtful leaders had never in their life been told to think of themselves as a Christian intellectual. Now, it was not always so. There was a time that within culture, pastors held weight. They were considered. They would be interviewed. They would be quoted. They'd be asked their opinion. Now, I ask you today, is that the way your culture thinks of you? I would say probably not. Now, some of that is things that we've given away. We've given some of that territory away. We've hidden, I think sometimes, erroneously, in just the thinking that we have belief and not knowledge. One of the things that JP does for us as students is he builds us up to say that you have a place, you have a seat at the table of ideas within culture, and you are called by Christ to sit there confidently, thoughtfully, reasoned, gently, but convinced that you have a place at the seat. You have a seat at the table of ideas, and you have something to contribute. And one of the things that philosophy does is it engages the culture at the level of ideas. And he just said something fascinating at breakfast with the presidential circle. He talked about plausibility structures. He talked about the cultural plausibility structure. And outside that plausibility structure, the belief system of a culture, people won't engage. So if people won't engage in a debate whether the earth is flat or not, right? Because it's silly. Of course, in the plausibility structure, we know, of course, it's not flat. And what he said was, what we find is Christianity is being moved out of the plausibility structure of the culture so that no longer do they think of it as reasoned. We need to, as pastors, move the church and our conviction and our belief back so that Christianity is a part of the plausibility structure. JP is uniquely qualified to do that. So it's my honor to introduce him to you as a man who's given his career to, for student and pastor, begin to introduce to them the confidence again through books like Love the Lord Your God with All Your Mind, his bestseller. Books like Lost Virtue of Happiness, which I just finished. And I hope today is a time of real equipping so that when you leave here, as he's done with me, you are more resourced and more confident to engage in the world of ideas as pastors and leaders in culture. So JP, come on up.
Good man. Well, thank you, my dear brother. And at my age, I'm going to sit down. it's a great joy to be here. I've was on staff with Campus Crusade for Christ for 10 years and did a lot of evangelism and discipleship. I have had the privilege of planting two churches and pastoring in others, and I have come to a couple of convictions, and one of them is that pastoring is the hardest job in America. It's not so much the hours. I mean, you guys only work one day a week, so I mean, that's it can't be the hours. But no, it's the hours, but it's also the emotional strain, the psychological strain, the sometimes the loneliness, the spiritual strain of having to care for people in a very crazy culture. So you have a hard job, and I don't want to add to that by giving you another burden guilt trip today. My hope is to equip you, to warn you about something, and then to give you some training in that you may find useful. The other thing is, as Dallas Willard taught me, he was my dissertation supervisor, the minister is the key to cultural transformation. It is the local church pastor that is the key to changing the world for Christ, to being involved in the war against good and evil, and in bringing transformation and enlightenment to people. The universities play a role. The arts and the Hollywood industry plays a role. But it really is the local church and the pastor that has the primary position. And so you have an incredibly high calling, and I urge you to do your job well, as best you can, and to take it with real seriousness. I've been where you've been, and God moved me into the academy because I realized that I was more of a professor with a pastor's heart than a pastor with a professor's heart, and it was just a matter of emphasis for me. Now, I'm going to warn you about some things today, and I'm going to give you a little bit of equipping to help address that warning. I don't want you to hear that this is another burden that you've got to add to your plate. So let's not do that. Let's enjoy this, listen,
If you find some of the things I'm sharing that ring true to you, it doesn't follow that you're the one who needs to do it. It follows that you need to make sure someone in your church is doing it, but not you don't have to be doing it. So receive what I'm sharing as best you can. We'll have a Q&A time where you can fuss at me all you want. But if you end up buying some of what I'm going to say, don't let it add another burden to your pile. If you want to own some of this, great. But if it's not you, try to think of someone on your staff or in your church that could facilitate these values and see them more prominent among your people. I want to begin with an experience I had. I had been speaking at a church in Seattle for the weekend. That it was Sunday morning. I was in the airport getting ready to come home to Southern California, picked up the newspaper and went to the editorial page. And on the front page was this editorial. It's actually the whole first page and then half the second page. This is a big editorial, syndicated, and the title of it was A Nation Divided. And the author went on to say that we now live in the most divided period of American history since the Civil War. Now, I'm inclined to think that's right. I don't know what you think about that. But what was really interesting to me was what he says was the major division. And he said, we're divided into two groups. That was wrong. We're actually divided into three groups. And I'll tell you what those groups are in a little bit. But he said the fundamental divide among the American people is not political. And that shocked me because politics is a fundamental difference among Americans. It's increasingly difficult to have civil discourse among Republicans and Democrats. He said it's not socioeconomic. He said the fundamental division is not racial, and the fundamental division is not gender. The fundamental thing dividing the American people is worldview. Worldview. And I practically fell off my chair because we Christians talk about that. You know, a worldview is the sum total of the things you believe about life's most important questions. That's what a worldview is. So Christianity, for example, is a worldview in addition to a relationship. This idea that we are involved in a division of worldview, actually into three worldviews, is an insight into what is moving the culture. Because what Christians need to do is to develop an ability to see the flow of ideas in a culture, to see where things are moving and why they're going there. And that's what I call worldview thinking, learning how to hear the news through a Christian perspective and understand the movement of ideas. Now, as a result of this worldview division, you and I are now considered ignorant bigots. Christianity has been considered a superstition and a myth, and people who follow it ignorant for a while. I mean, that has waxed and waned in Western culture. But this is now the first time in the history of the West since Jesus was executed that the moral teachings of Jesus are considered to be immoral and bigoted. So Christian morality now is considered to be a harm to people. So novelist Jane Smiley said the following. Here is how their ignorant bigotry works, speaking of me and you. First, they put the fear of God into you. If you don't believe in the literal word of the Bible, you'll burn in hell. Of course, the literal word of the Bible is tremendously contradictory. And so, if you're going to be a Christian, you have to abdicate critical thinking. And you have to accept a simple system of belief that's dangerous to question. And a corollary of this point is that they make sure you understand that the devil resides in the toils and snares of complex thought, so it's best not to try to think at all. And so we are painted as people who are largely non-thinkers. We don't like thinking. We like worship music. Christianity is about faith, isn't it? I mean, it doesn't have anything to do with reason or knowledge. And so that's the general depiction of us as we continue to be marginalized and as the culture continues to become increasingly secularized as time goes on. We are heading toward Europe. And if the inertia continues as it is, we will be European in about 10 years because there are forces in place that are designed to secularize the American people and place Christianity as nothing but a bigoted superstition that can't be backed by any reason or evidence. Now, here's what Robert Reich said. He was the Secretary of Labor under the Clinton administration, professor of Harvard, and has a pretty important spokesperson. He's on MSNBC and other places. Now listen to this. This doesn't shock you, I don't know what will. He says the greatest conflict of the 21st century is not gonna be between the West and terrorism. That's a statement, because I'd say that's a pretty substantial conflict. But he says that's not the biggest one. Terrorism is a tactic, but not a belief. No, the real battle isn't between terrorists and America, the West. The true battle lies between modern civilization and anti-modernists, between those who believe in the primacy of the individual and those who believe that human beings owe their allegiance to a higher power, between those who give priority to life in this world and those who believe that human life is a preparation for existence beyond the grave. Now, between those who believe in science, reason, and logic, and those who believe that truth is revealed through scripture and religious dogma. Terrorism will disrupt and destroy lives, but terrorism itself is not the greatest danger we face. Conservative Christianity is. And that's because we're people who don't believe in reason or logic or science. We're not thinkers. We don't know how to think. We're feelers, we're believers. We challenge people to believe things, but we don't ask them to know things. So now this raises a question. Once we understand the three central worldviews that are a part of the struggle of ideas. By the way, later on, I'll be sure, as I end, we'll have plenty of time for Q&A and discussion, okay? Now, one of the three worldviews that is contending for allegiance is, I'm glad to say, conservative Christianity. We still have a voice. It's weakening to some degree, but we still have influence on people, on the way things are discussed, and so Christian theism is one of the ideas, one of the worldviews. The second worldview is by far the dominant worldview of American culture, without question. And it's called scientific naturalism. And scientific naturalism is the idea that the physical world is all there is. There's nothing that exists that is not physical. Okay, so you and I are told that our thoughts and memories are in our brains. An idea that no Christian should believe, but we're told that your thoughts and memories are stored in your brain, which is not true, completely false. I'll show you that next hour. And there's no life after death because you are your brain and central nervous system. So if everything's physical, life after death becomes something that fewer and fewer people believe in, because if you're your brain and your nervous system, when you're dead, you're extinct. There's nothing to survive. So the scientific naturalist says that the physical world is all there is and everything in the world is nothing but physical, right? And secondly, the only kind of knowledge that we can have comes from the hard sciences and that can be tested with your five senses. Now, this means that chemistry and physics and biology and neuroscience are fields that provide us with reliable, trustworthy knowledge. Other fields like ethics or theology or philosophy or political thought do not rise to the level of knowledge. Nobody can know anything in these fields. You can make a claim that Jesus is the Son of God or that abortion is wrong, but who knows? Nobody knows the answer to those questions. Why? Because you can't test them scientifically. And if you can't test them scientifically, you can have personal faith in it. You just can't know it's true. That's why Oprah Winfrey feels free to talk about theology on her TV shows, whereas she would not feel free to pontificate about smallpox or some scientific issue, because in science we have what? Experts. What's an expert? Somebody who knows something. There aren't any experts in theology and ethics because nobody knows anything. There's nothing to be known. It's all about your feelings. And if religion is primarily about choosing to believe something and having faith in it and feeling about it, then I will grant you Oprah is an expert on her faith and her beliefs and her feelings. So she has a right to speak as much as a professor at a seminary, because nobody really knows the truth at the end of the day. I was invited to a dinner party where I was going to share the gospel. There were about 20 people that came. I was warned that there was a physicist who got his doctorate from Johns Hopkins and had been an engineer for about 25 years, was invited to come, and he hated Christians. And he went out of his way to ridicule and mock Christians. And so I'm at the hors d'oeuvre table, and I see my friend come in with a gentleman, what I assumed it was his boss, and they came over to the hors d'oeuvre table. He introduced us to one another, and no sooner did we finish niceties, and then he said, "Say, I understand you're a philosopher and a theologian." And I said, "Well, you know, I give it my best shot." And he said, "Well, I used to be interested in that stuff myself when I was a teenager. But he said, I grew out of it when I became an adult, because I came to realize that if you can't quantify your data and test it in a lab, you can't know it. And it's nothing but a bunch of hot air." Now, that's what people believe in this culture. Science now carries the authority. Pastors don't. Because science has the right to define reality and tell us what's real. Religious people can, you know, share meaning and values and all that stuff if you need that kind of thing. But you know, so Barbara Wawa has a show on heaven, and I told my wife, I can tell you right now where this is going. At the end, she will conclude, "Well, is there life after death? You know, nobody knows, but maybe that's okay, because probably life after death is one of those things that requires faith in the first place." And that's exactly the way she concluded. You can't know if there's life after, by the way, you can know there's life after death. And I'd be glad to talk to you about that. This is not something I believe. This is something I know is real. And the Christian community needs to begin to propagate its ideas as things that we know to be true, not things we have faith in or believe to be true. Because the church has always seen itself as a knowledge tradition. That is, it has seen itself as providing knowledge to people who followed the faith, at least in its central teachings. It never saw itself as giving people beliefs or things to be accepted by faith. It always saw itself as a knowledge tradition. Well, I let this gentleman talk about 2 minutes. And I said, "You know, sir, I got a problem. Maybe you can help me with it. You're claiming that if something can't be quantified and tested empirically in the lab, that it's hot air, can't be known." He said, "Yes, sir, that's what I'm saying." And I said, "For the last 2 minutes, you've made 30 assertions, and I can't think of a single one of them that could be quantified and tested empirically. If I'm wrong about that, would you remind me of what you said in the last 2 minutes that you could test in a laboratory? And if you can't, then my problem is that what you've been doing for the last 2 minutes is wasting our time with nothing but a bunch of hot air." Now, the point is that the statement that science is the only source of knowledge we have is self-refuting. It's like the statement, "There's no sentence longer than three words." That sentence falsifies itself. And the statement that you can only know what science can demonstrate is not itself something science can demonstrate. In fact, that statement is not a statement of science. It's a statement of philosophy about science, to the effect that there are no statements of philosophy you can know. Well, that's a pretty hard place to live. And it was a very short conversation. But you see, those are the kinds of little tools our people need to know so they're not bullied. People need to learn how to share their faith beyond their testimony. You start with a testimony, but it's criminal for a Christian to be a 10-year-old believer and still be sharing their testimony. They need to be able to share why they believe what they believe, besides that your changed life. So the third worldview is called postmodern relativism. Postmodern relativism. Scientific naturalism flourishes in the news media. It occupies the power centers of the university. You go on a university campus, and it's the various science buildings that get the funding and the money, and they're the money power centers of culture, and the media are overwhelmingly naturalistic. Postmodern relativism basically says that all truth and reality and value is relative to your community or your group. And what's real and true and right and wrong for your group is not necessarily what's real or true or right and wrong for another group, and nobody's wrong. Everybody's right relative to their group. That's why it's intolerant for you to try to force another group to accept your beliefs, because there are no beliefs that are true for everybody, except, of course, postmodernism. But apart from that, there are no other beliefs that are true for everybody. So now what this has done is this has created a situation in the culture that our people live in. And the question today is no longer, is Christianity true? Because I can go on a college campus and say, I think Christianity is true because it changed my life and I have very deep personal feelings about Christianity, and I'll be on that, but people won't kick me off campus. The real question today is not, is Christianity true? The real question is, can it be known to be true? Can you know it's true? That's the question. Now, why does that matter that we answer that question? Because we give people authority in culture on the basis of their possession of knowledge and not just true beliefs. Illustration. My next door neighbor likes me a lot more than my dentist, but I let my dentist put his hands in my mouth. I've never let my next door neighbor put his hands in my mouth. And it's because I assume my dentist possesses a body of knowledge. If he said to me, you know, I've got a lot of very deeply held beliefs about molars and so on that mean a lot to me, and I'm committed to these beliefs and I feel very deeply about them, and I personally think they're true, I'm out of there because I'm not interested in what he believes. I want to know what he knows. People do not govern their lives based on what they believe. They govern their lives based on what they take themselves to know, whether they rightly or wrongly know it. They govern their lives based on what they take themselves to know. So the doctor has more authority in community than the pastor, because the doctor possesses a body of knowledge that's been scientifically demonstrated, whereas the pastor has a bunch of non-scientifically testable ideas that no one can know is true. And so Christianity has no authority because it is not given the support of knowledge. It cannot be known to be the case. Knowledge gives people authority to speak and act in culture. If you want to marginalize Christianity, then you want to make people think that the Christian church does not possess knowledge of anything. Instead, it possesses a bunch of propositions that are personally believed by people who need that kind of thing, and that may be useful and helpful for certain people, you know, pragmatically helpful. But that we can know they're true, no, that's out of the question. And that is the fundamental issue that is marginalizing us and helping us slouch toward a secular Gomorrah. It is the knowledge issue. It is not the truth issue anymore. Now, what I'd like to do is to define truth and knowledge for you, because I'm convinced, as our brothers and sisters for up until, I'm going to say, around 1930, and from 1930 until the present, we haven't believed this, but the church up until 1930 has always believed that Christianity was a source of knowledge. Not, like I told you, not belief. Astrology is a belief tradition. It's a history of ideas that people choose to believe. But you can't know whether astrology is true. You understand what I'm saying there? Chemistry is a knowledge tradition. It is a history of ideas that not only do its practitioners believe to be true, but they claim that they can actually know that certain chemical principles are true. I say Christianity is more like chemistry than astrology. The Christian church not only has propositions that it believes to be true, but we can actually know that these central teachings are true. So that raises the question of what is it to know something and what is truth. So let me go over some of these, and we'll see if we can make some progress. What is truth? Here's a simple definition of truth. Truth is when things are the way one takes them to be. Truth is when things are the way one takes them to be. If I take grass to be green and things are the way I take them to be, namely that grass is actually green, then my belief is true. And it's true not because I take it to be a certain way, it's true because reality is actually the way I take it to be. Another way to put this is that truth is a matching relationship between a thought or an assertion and reality. If a thought or a belief or an assertion matches reality, it's true. If it doesn't match reality, it's false. And so when we say the Bible's true, we mean that when properly interpreted, its assertions match reality. A false prophet was someone whose assertions failed to match reality. So truth is just a matching relationship between a thought or a belief or an assertion, an idea, and the real world. And if they match or correspond to one another, you have truth. Now, you can have truth without knowing you have it. You could believe that there are a certain number of mountains on the back of the moon before we went there, and you could be right about it, but you wouldn't know that you were right, but you may actually have the truth. Or consider a world where everybody was born blind. So nobody in this world has ever seen anything. And a little guy named Joe is walking across the street with his cane, and all of a sudden a thought comes through his mind out of nowhere, grass is green. And he says, where did that come from? He just barely knows what it means. His thought is true. Grass actually is green, but he doesn't know it's true, and neither does anybody else. So truth has to do with matching with reality, not evidence. There's a difference between having the truth and knowing that you have the truth. Okay? So that's what truth is. Now, what is knowledge? What is knowledge? There are three kinds of knowledge, and in my own view, our people need to be taught these simple ideas. The first is called knowledge by direct experience. Knowledge by direct experience. I have knowledge by direct experience of the yellow on this piece of paper. When you have knowledge by direct experience, that means that you're directly aware of something. You're just aware of it directly. Now, this happens with our five senses. I have five grandchildren, and the marvel of their learning language is something that makes my head explode. I have no idea how these little creatures learn to speak, but it happens, and it's just, it's literally a miracle. But when a little child sees several red objects, there's an apple, and there's a fire truck, and there's a ball, and this happens every day, they're able to focus on what those objects have in common and to be aware of it. They can be aware of red without even having a concept of what red is. So a little child has no concept of red and can't think about red, but still has an awareness of red. So knowledge by direct experience is a fundamental kind of knowledge. Now, this kind of knowledge goes beyond the five senses. Okay, let me give you an example. Knowledge of your own consciousness through introspection, when you close your eyes and say, what's going on inside of me right now, is knowledge by direct experience. Because what you confront are feelings and thoughts and desires and other things that are a part of your conscious life. But you cannot see, touch, taste, smell, or hear consciousness. Consciousness is completely invisible. You can be directly aware of it, but you can't see it or touch it or taste it or smell it or hear it. So consciousness is an example of knowledge by direct experience that does not involve the senses. So is mathematics and logic. We know the truths of mathematics and logic not by our senses. This is going to be probably the most technical thing I'll share. And I'll share it and then I'll apologize. But consider the statement, all ravens are black. Now that is a generalization based upon our senses. We've seen a bunch of ravens and there hadn't been one that wasn't black yet, so we rightly generalize and claim all ravens are black. Note carefully that while that statement is known through the senses, the statement is contingent, meaning that even though it's true, it could have been false. There's no contradiction in the idea that there could have been a white raven. Do you understand? So it's a true statement, but it's not a necessary truth. It's a contingent truth. It's a truth that, though true, could have easily been false. Mathematics and logical laws are not contingent truths, they're necessary truths. So take the statement 2 + 2 = 4. That's very different than all ravens are black, because you can't conceive of a world where even God himself could make 2 + 2 = √-1. 2 + 2 = 4, all right? It has to be 4. Similarly, modus ponens, which is a little simple law of logic, which says if P then Q and P, therefore Q. If it's raining outside, then it's wet, and it's raining, therefore it's wet. That proposition is a necessary truth. Again, even God could not create a world where modus ponens was false. So logical laws and mathematical propositions are not known by the senses. They're known by a form of direct awareness that the mind has the power to exercise. The mind can be directly aware of the laws of logic and mathematics through knowledge by direct experience, but those aren't the five senses. Now, Christianity gives knowledge by direct experience. How? There have been times in my life where I have directly been aware of God himself. God has shown up and I have been directly aware that he was there. I've been aware of his being and his presence. There have been times when God has spoken to me, and I was aware that it was he that was speaking to me. I've made mistakes on that, but there have been times I've known by awareness that God was asking me to do something or telling me to do something. And so that is a form of knowledge by direct acquaintance. And there's nothing illegitimate about that. What's wrong with that? Well, isn't there knowledge by direct awareness outside of religion? Yeah. Isn't there knowledge by direct awareness outside of religion that doesn't involve the five senses? Hello. Introspective knowledge, knowledge of logic, knowledge of mathematics. They're non-sense perceptible direct knowledge by experience is all over the map. So why would we have fuss at somebody being aware of God or being aware of him talking to me? There is knowledge by direct awareness of demons. I have been involved in some exorcisms, and there have been times when I have been aware of the presence of demons in a room. I was in a gym sitting at the mid-court line, 1,500 to 2,000 people in the gym. Christian speaker was going to speak, and I was talking to somebody and felt the presence of dark demonic presence come in the gym, and I looked over and there were three young men who walked in the gym. They're way over there, and I noted where they sat. So after the meeting was over with, I went over to talk to them, and I introduced myself and I said, "Tell me, why did you come to the meeting tonight?" And they all three said, "We are involved in a local coven and we are a part of the occult, and we came to speak curses against this meeting while we were here." I sensed the demons in those men from across the court. And I'll bet there are people in here that have sensed demonic presences. People can be aware of angels. There are many Christians that have had direct experiences and awarenesses of angels. So Christianity provides knowledge by acquaintance. Okay, that's the first kind of knowledge. Are you guys okay? Okay. Are you bored? Okay. All right. Do you like me? Okay. All right. Okay. The second kind of knowledge is an important kind of knowledge. And this is called propositional knowledge. Propositional knowledge. And this, let me define it. This is a true belief based on adequate reasons. This is a true belief based on adequate reasons. I can't tell you what adequate reasons means in general, because it will mean one thing in art, another thing in chemistry, another thing in history, another thing in theology, another thing in metaphysics. So you have to start with cases, okay? But if you know the interpretation of a text, you've done your homework, and you actually know what that passage says, then you have a true belief about the passage that's based on adequate reasons. That's what propositional knowledge is. Now let's break this down. If you know something, your belief has got to be true. If you claim to know something and later found out that what you thought you knew was false, you would immediately withdraw the claim to know it and say, "Well, I thought I knew it, but I must have been mistaken." So, to have propositional knowledge, what you believe must be true. It's got to match reality. Secondly, you have to believe it. Now, what does it mean to believe something? That is to accept it as true between 51 and 100% certainty. So if you believe something, you take it to be true, and you're at least 51% sure you're right, up to 100% sure you're right. Okay, so you would have a true belief, but that's not knowledge. That's not knowledge. Let me tell you why. Suppose down in Southern California at Newport Beach, there is a public men's restroom, and that we have a drunk that just drinks 24/7, and his job is just to drink and to hang around the men's room. And he's formed the habit of believing everything written on the second stall of the men's room at Newport Beach. His motto is, "The stall says it, I believe it, that settles it." Okay, so He goes in and he sees George Washington was first president of the United States. And he doesn't even know what a president is. The guy has no clue. He's never heard of George Washington. Never heard of a president. But he says, dadgummit, it's on a stall. I'm with you. That's true. Okay, now compare him to a historian who has a true belief about George Washington based upon doing a lot of work in congressional records of those times, letters and newspaper articles and so on. Now, let's ask about our two figures here. What do they have in common? And they have two things in common. First, they have the truth, right? Both of them believe the truth. The second thing they have in common is they have the same belief. So they share true beliefs. But one of them has knowledge about those true beliefs. The other doesn't, because his true belief is based on adequate grounds. And so as pastors, when we teach, we are not simply interested in giving people true beliefs. We want to give them knowledge. And the difference is that when we give them true belief, we teach them what to believe. When we give them knowledge, we teach them why to believe it. And we give them adequate grounds. Now, you can have knowledge without having certainty that you're right. This is very important for you to keep in mind. And I want to draw a distinction between epistemological certainty and psychological or spiritual certainty. I'm talking about epistemological certainty. What does that mean? That means it is impossible I'm mistaken. So you can have knowledge and admit that it's possible you're wrong, because knowledge requires adequate reasons, not conclusive reasons. So I know God exists, but I admit I might be wrong. You can know God exists and have doubts and questions that you can't answer. So knowing God exists does not require you to be to such a point that you are completely certain intellectually about it without any possibility of being mistaken. The only thing that I have certainty about in that regard is my own existence and the fundamental truths of math and logic. I do not have certainty that God exists, but I know he exists because I have a true belief based on adequate reasons. Now, psychological certainty. I don't say our Father who probably art in heaven because my spirit at this point in my life is completely convinced that God is real. I think that's a matter of personality. Some people are perfectionists and doubters by nature, and that's okay. So if you're not psychologically certain that God exists, it's probably an emotional problem, unless you can put your finger specifically on the thing causing your doubt. And if you can write it down in a paragraph or two, then it's an intellectual problem and it needs an answer. If you can't put it down and it's just a vague sense of something, it's probably due to abandonment issues and failure to attach, not learning how to attach as a child. That's the difference. Okay, you can know something then without being certain about it. Ephesians 5, Paul says, "This I want you to know with certainty." And that presupposes that you can know things without certainty, or it would have been a redundant statement. If I said I want hamburgers with pickles, please, and pickles were just parts of hamburgers, then I wouldn't need to say that. I'd just say, give me a hamburger, because pickles would come. The fact that I say I want a hamburger with pickles presupposes it's possible to have a hamburger without pickles. For Paul to say, this I want you to know with certainty, presupposes that you could know some things but not be certain about them. So when I say that I have propositional knowledge that the Christian God is real, that Jesus rose from the dead, that there is life after death, I know these things. These are not things that I just believe. I am claiming that I have a true belief about these things that's based on solid grounds and so on. Now, the third kind of knowledge that we provide, the first was knowledge by direct experience. The second was propositional knowledge that does not require people to have certainty. Okay, that's very key. The third kind is know-how or skill. know-how or skill, and that is the ability to do something well. So my father had know-how or skill when it came to automobiles, but he couldn't, fixing cars, but he couldn't tell me how he knew what he just looked in there and said, well, this is your problem. And he just dropped, and my head would explode. Of course, but there's knowledge of right and wrong without a Bible. And so the fundamental place that we get our primitive understanding of right or wrong is not from Scripture, but it's from the natural moral law. If we did not have a sense of the difference between right and wrong before we picked up a Bible, we would have absolutely no way of telling whether Jesus was a good person or a bad person. Because we would have no understanding of right or wrong before we picked up the book. So judging that the God of the Bible is a good being presupposes that we already have some knowledge of goodness. Now, knowledge of right and wrong is independent of Scripture, but not God's existence. There wouldn't be any right and wrong if there weren't a God. That's a different point. But what I'm suggesting is that our fundamental learning of right and wrong comes from truths that God has embedded in the creation that we can know even if we don't know God or even if we've never seen the Scripture. It's very important for people to understand that the natural moral law is what we need to use in dialoguing with unbelieving people about moral issues. Because if we use the Bible, it's legitimate to use the Bible to communicate a Christian view of it. That's perfectly legitimate. But if you're trying to persuade people about a certain view in a secular, in a government that we don't want to be a theocracy, at least I don't. I don't want a theocracy. I don't want the state under the authority of Scripture, because I think that we tried that in early American history and it drives unbelievers away. I think what we want is the state under the natural moral law. So if I'm going to dialogue about abortion, I'm going to start with premises that are pretty self-evident. And we have moral knowledge from the natural moral law by being aware of the self-evident nature of these teachings. So for example, it's self-evident that torturing little babies for the fun of it's wrong. That's self-evident. It's self-evident that love is a virtue, not a vice. It's self-evident that kindness and courage are virtues, not vices. It's self-evident that being a self-centered narcissistic slob is a vice, not a virtue. We start our moral knowledge with intuitively self-evident principles from the natural moral law that, as C.S. Lewis pointed out, all the great cultures of the world agree on these fundamental moral teachings because they have access to the moral law. Now remember, the state's job or the job of the natural moral law is not to transform people's lives and tell them everything that's right or wrong. It's simply to give enough to where people know that they're condemned and to be able to have some understanding of a moral universe, that's all. For a full knowledge of right and wrong, you need Holy Scripture, and transformation requires regeneration and so on. Those are different things. Now, I'll close with this. How would I try to show that there are moral absolutes? Which, by a moral absolute, I mean a moral proposition that's true, whether anybody believes it or not. So we discover morality, we don't invent it. A moral absolute is a moral proposition that's true, whether anybody believes it or not. Now, how do we know there are such things? Well, there are two ways. The first I already gave you, some of them are self-evident, it's 2 and 2 is 4. I mean, if somebody's gonna deny that kindness is a virtue, they need therapy, not an argument. So self-evident. The second way we know that there are moral absolutes is if we find a relativist, find out what they care about, act like it's relative, and see what happens. This literally happened about 15 years ago. I was in a stop and go, and the guy in line, we got to talking about morality. I don't know how it happened. And he said, yeah, he says, you know, there's some people that are judgmental and think they ought to shove their moral values in everybody. Not me. I think whatever is morally right for you is right for you, and what's morally right for another fellow is right for them, and people should have their own moral standards and just live and let live. And I said, okay, that's an interesting view. I said, found out he loved the environment. And so I said, you know, I've got 4 friends. And once a month, we kick $50 a piece, $250 kitty, into a fund, and then we go buy a 100-gallon drum of sulfuric acid, and we drive out to Lake Paris, and we go to the middle and dump the acid in the lake, and we've taken bets ahead of time as to about how many fish we'll kill. And whoever gets closest to the number of fish that float to the surface wins the $250 minus the cost of the sulfuric acid. I said, it is a blast. And his blood vessels. And I said, you know, looks to me like you think what my friends and I are doing is wrong. So it occurs to me, you're not a relativist. You're just a relativist in areas of your life like your sexual morality that's convenient to your lifestyle. Now, this is a real example of this. A friend of mine did his PhD at the University of North Carolina, and there was a radical relativist female professor there that did not believe in any absolutes that was asked to go lecture at a Saudi Arabian university. And she told her doctoral students, I don't know what I'm going to do. Because I'm a relativist, I have no right to impose my values on theirs because there are no true values for everybody. But I can't stand the way they treat women. Well, she gets over there and guess what she did? She scolded them for their treatment of women. She couldn't live out her moral relativism because she knows it's baloney. So don't be in a position of proving that there are absolutes. You make other people be in a position of proving there aren't. Okay, knowledge is important, and that's what I've tried to say, and let's talk. We have about 10 minutes, so maybe get a mic or something. There's a brother back there. Yes.
So I guess it's going all the way back to Thucydides, who basically his whole theme was whoever has the power dictates the absolute. How to address that context in the nation of Rome? They had their own absolutes also. And yet there was a minority, which was Christianity, who was asserting God's absolute.
Yes.
Where we are.
Yes, great point. Obviously, power can distort people's ability to perceive the natural moral law. Nevertheless, we're assured, I believe, in Romans and other texts that God believes that people still have the ability to be aware of it because it serves as a basis of their condemnation. So my view would be, number one, it's not like the Romans were entirely wrong. They did have some moral beliefs that were objectively true, moral absolutes. They were wrong on some of them, but some of them they were right about. The second thing is that when Paul and others would go throughout the empire and they would share a Christian view of things, people intuitively sensed that this was a good thing and correct. There was a rightness about the teachings of Jesus that they intuitively sensed, so that the empire was not able to fully snuff out a person's ability to sense the good against the evil, though it was harmed. So in our case, when I talk to an unbeliever or I'm discussing a moral topic, I assume, like you, that this person is fallen and in an empire and may have drunk the Kool-Aid. On the other hand, there is still the image of God in them, and I have to assume that with the Spirit's help, that the things I'm going to say to them is going to get to them somehow down in there. And I have to have that confidence. But you're right. This is a filter that is a problem, though I don't think it's a home run. It's a grand slam home run, would be my view. Yes, sir.
I turned 60 this year, and I found out that when I came through university, the modernist viewpoint was dominant.
Yes.
Now there's a generation and a half. The postmodern mindset is dominant. And, so one of my challenges as a pastor is you're talking to a congregation about truth and biblical truth, and yet many of your believers have bought into a postmodern mentality, consciously or unconsciously, and they really don't care if something can be demonstrated to be true or not. How do you, you're speaking now to that generation.
Yeah.
How do you get through? How do you communicate?
And, yeah. My own view is that the size of the postmodern influence has been overstated. It's there. I'm with you on that. But its influence is waning, and it's been overstated. People, you can get 2,000 people to show up on a university campus to hear a lecture on an argument for God's existence or a debate about whether there's a God, because people are still interested in evidence for things. They really are. And they pack out. You get a postmodern relativist who gets up to talk about something and he'll get 50 people to show up. So people are still flocking to folks who are willing to give a basis for what they believe. They really do. And so I think we hold the line. The first thing that we do with the postmodern folk that have been kind of sucked into that framework in the church is to obviously be gracious and tell stories that they can relate to, and sometimes pack the reasons for what we believe in story form. That is one way that you can do it. You're giving reasons for something. So suppose that in preaching, if I'm preaching a text, I try to find backing for the reasonableness of that text from examples in daily life that show, doggone it, this really is true. By showing statistics about what happened if you violate this, you know, it doesn't go well for you. So I would say storytelling with, like C.S. Lewis packed a lot of stuff into story, may run an in-run around their resistance. You're still using some good reasons in there, but they're in the form of a story. That's the best way I can help you. But people still want to know, why the heck do you think that's the case? I really think they do. But I'm with you that it's still there.
Maybe just one more?
Absolutely.
Before a break? Okay.
You said that maybe we need to stop using the word belief and start using more of the word knowledge.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts just from a pastor's perspective of like maybe not ceasing to use one but use the other one just as much,
okay,
as well as maybe helping our people redefine belief as just stab in the dark and teaching them about knowledge?
Okay. Good idea. I guess what I would do personally would be to put a ban on the word faith for 10 years and just not use the word. What I would use in its place is trust or confidence, because the word faith has become vacuous. It means absolutely nothing. But another word to use is trust or confidence. And so instead of saying, I have faith in God, I would rather say, I want you to have confidence or trust in God. Those are more pregnant in their texture. So I would say, I'm with you, that we still need to use the concepts, and maybe the belief word is okay, but the faith word, it's just a problem. No, it just means nothing to anybody. But confidence and trust seems to me to carry a little bit of more gravitas. And then I like your idea of being sure to clarify that when I say belief or faith, I mean trusting something in someone or that something's true. But I also know that someone or that something's true because we have some good grounds, or I was aware of him when he came to me in prayer or something of that sort. So I really like that suggestion. I think it's a very good idea.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, JP.
Thank you for even listening. I appreciate him listening. Thank you.
Realizing that your brains can only absorb what your bottoms can endure. Amen?
Amen.
We want to give you about a 10-minute break. Please help yourself.
At least 10 minutes.
At least 10 minutes. 15-minute break. Help yourself to more coffee, juice, fruit. Restrooms are out the door to the left in the blue building. Stand up, stretch a little bit, say hi to somebody you don't know. We'll get going in 15 minutes. All right, did you enjoy that first session?
Yeah.
Woo! That was good stuff, wasn't it? Good stuff. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it back over if I've not forgotten anything or anybody have any other quick questions for me. I'll jump up at the end, answer a few questions. JP's going to also open it for some more questions at the end of this session, of course, so that you'll be able to ask some other great questions. Get those in your mind, what you'd like to have answered, and let's enjoy this time. Thanks, JP.
Thank you. Good use of manipulation, by the way. there are some appropriate uses of it, and you did a good job of manipulating people. All right. I want to give you some training in something that you typically won't be able to find anywhere. And so I was asked about the first lecture, if you want to read something on that. I wrote a book called The Kingdom Triangle that contains a more detailed analysis of what I shared. I want to talk about neuroscience, consciousness, and the soul. And let me tell you why I want to talk about it. The first decade of the 20th century was declared the decade of the brain. And there was a tremendous effort placed on funding neuroscientific research into the brain's central nervous system. Now, as a result of that, there are in the media, in Time and Newsweek and newspapers, on the television news and so on, there are statements that are being made about the human person that are not true, and they're inconsistent with Christianity, but these statements are demonstrably false. But as a result of this, there's been a loss of belief in the soul. And so more and more people have replaced the soul with the brain. And they think that it's the brain that thinks and so on. And so we have, without it being intentional, a slow encroachment of materialism. Now, I tell people animals have souls. And they look at me like I you know, just came from Mars. What they don't know is that in the entire history of the church believed that animals had souls until two people came along, Descartes and Darwin. Descartes said humans have souls and animals are machines, and Descartes said there can be no souls if evolution's true. That's one of the reasons I don't believe in the general theory of evolution, is because it cannot explain the origin of consciousness and the soul, because these aren't physical and you can't get something from nothing. If you start with particles and rearrange them, you're going to end up with rearranged particles. If you start with a logos, then you can have consciousness and mind, because you start with mind. But in any case, if we do not help correct this kind of stuff, we're going to be in trouble. There are more and more books, Christian books, written on counseling, and are bringing in issues of the brain into spiritual growth and transformation. Now, I think that's an okay thing, but the people that are writing on these things don't know what they're talking about. And so they're making statements that undermine Christianity without trying to. They don't mean to do it. They're just becoming the church's gravedigger by the things they're saying. And so what I want to do is to help clarify these issues. I'm going to show you before we're finished that what consciousness and the soul are, or if there is consciousness and a soul, has absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with neuroscience. Neuroscience cannot even formulate the right questions, much less provide answers to them. This is a totally extra scientific question, and it's a question of philosophy and theology. It's not a question of science. So we'll talk about that. So and it's important because we want people to understand that they are embodied souls that have an immaterial aspect to their nature, and that they will not cease to exist when their body is dead, because they are not their bodies. They have a body, but they're not their bodies. Okay, so let me begin by way of introduction. I'm going to give you two principles that will help you understand the discussion to follow. If you want more on this, there's a book called A Brief History of the Soul by two guys. One of them is named Stuart Goetz, G-O-E-T-Z, A Brief History of the Soul. Just remember his name and you can get it on Amazon. It's a great book. And then I, a year ago, came out with a book called The Soul, How We Know It's Real and Why It Matters. So those would be, I think, accessible books if you're interested in looking into this question more. Okay, here's the first introductory remark that I'd like to make, and it is the nature of states and the things that have them. So you might want to put down states and the things that have them. Now, water can exist in three states: solid, liquid, and gas, right? But a state has to be possessed by something. States don't float around on their own. They always belong to something. And the state, these three states of solid, liquid, and gas belong to water. So water is the thing that has the states. The states are simply changes that go on in the water. Does that make sense? And so when it comes to the human person, we can ask, what are the states of consciousness? Because there are five states of consciousness that I'll give you in a minute. And we can ask, what is the thing that has those states? And those are different questions. Okay, do you see how those are different? What are the states of consciousness? And are they physical or non-physical? Once we deal with that question, we have a second question, and that is, what is it that has consciousness? Is it the brain, or is it the ego and the soul? And how do we know? How do we decide that? So that's the first thing, that there are states, and there are things that have those states, and they're different. The thing that has the state is different from the state itself. The second thing that I want to point out is called the law of identity. the law of identity. And identity says that if A is identical to B, and that just means A is the same thing as B, you don't have two things, A and B. You've got one thing, A, which is the same thing as B. Okay, so if A is identical to B, whatever is true of A will be true of B, and vice versa. So, suppose A is the color of the sky, and B is my wife's favorite color. If A is identical to B, then whatever is true of the color of the sky, it's lighter than purple, had better be true of my wife's favorite color. It ought to be lighter than purple. If there's one thing that's true of the color of the sky that's not true of my wife's favorite color, what does that tell us? They're not the same thing. So identity provides us with a test for telling when A is not the same thing as B. Namely, if there's at least one thing true of A that is not true of B, or vice versa, they cannot be the same thing. Now note that identity, being the same thing as, is different than cause and effect. If A causes B, that doesn't show that A is B. So if fire causes smoke, that doesn't prove fire is smoke. Does that make sense? So if I touch an electrode in a certain region of a person's brain, and that causes a sparking of a neuron in the brain, which we can call a brain event. Let's call that B, brain event. And there is a mental event, namely a memory of a grandmother in a certain dress. The fact that by touching that electrode and it causes a brain event and then a mental event doesn't prove that the brain event is the same thing as the mental event. If the brain event is the same thing as the mental event, then whatever's true of B had better be true of M, the mental event. What is actually going on here is that the brain event is causing the mental event. But that doesn't demonstrate they're the same thing. That makes sense to you? Now, identity is also different from dependency. Dependency. Right? So, just because a person's ability to have memories depends on certain regions of the brain working. And if those regions of the brain don't work, as with Alzheimer's or something, that does not prove that the brain events in that region of the brain are the same thing as memories, and it doesn't prove that the memories are in that region of the brain. All that shows is that the ability to have memories requires the brain to work. Same with the eyes. If my eyes don't work, I can't see. But that doesn't prove that my sensations of objects are in my eyes. It just proves that there is a dependency that having a sensation has on the eyes working. It doesn't prove identity. Okay, so we want to keep that in mind. Because those are two preliminaries. Now, the second, Roman numeral 2, if you want to put that introduction, Roman numeral 1, that'd be fine. Roman numeral 2, the nature of consciousness. Let me define consciousness. And then I'll give you the states of consciousness and explain why consciousness is not physical. There is no way to define consciousness except ostensively. Now, what does that mean? An ostensive definition is a definition of something by pointing to it. Because we sometimes define one thing in terms of one word in terms of other words, A bachelor is an unmarried male. We define those words in terms of other words, but that can't go on forever. We have to reach things that are defined not in terms of other words, but by pointing. So I might say by yellow, I mean that right there, okay? You cannot define consciousness except by pointing to examples of it. And if something had never had consciousness, it would not be able to understand the definition by pointing, okay? So let me give you an illustration now of what consciousness is. Suppose that you had an operation on your knee and you have been completely under anesthesia. You're in the waiting room and all of a sudden you start smelling something and it smells like hospital. And you start feeling a throbbing in your knee. And then you start having thoughts. The thought is, I'm not at home, I don't think. And then a belief forms. Oh my gosh, I'm in the hospital. And then all of a sudden you have a feeling of thirst. And that feeling of thirst brings about a desire to have a drink. And then you exercise your free will by moving your lips and saying, if there's anybody can hear me, would you bring me something to drink? Now, what is happening is you are regaining consciousness, and that's what consciousness is. Now, I'm going to give you another characterization of consciousness, but this is not a real definition, but it's a characteristic. Namely, there is a what it is like to be conscious. There is a what it is like to be conscious. So, take a pain. There is a what it is like to be in pain, right? Namely, a certain feeling of hurt. There is a what it is like to feel anger. There is a what it is like to be thinking about the presidency. There is a what it is like to having a desire for ice cream. So consciousness is sentience or awareness. You can't define it any more basically. It's having states such that there is a what it's like to it. Okay? So for any mental state you have, it's characterized by what it is like to be in that state. Right? So you just think about the different mental states, and there will always be what it's like to have that state. So consciousness is being awake. It's being sentient. It's being aware. It's having a what it's like to be in some state or another. Now, there are five states of consciousness. California doesn't happen to be one of them. But there are five states, any state that would have Moonbeam as a governor, I don't know, that just, I'm from Missouri and I go back, who's your governor, Moonbeam? I mean, golly, you know. Okay. There are five states of consciousness. The first is called a sensation. A sensation. A sensation would be something like the experience of red, or the awareness of music, an awareness of a sound, that's a sensation. The tasting of a lemon would be a sensation, okay? Now, some sensations go outside your body. For example, a taste of a lemon reaches out to the lemon. A sensation of hearing music here is a sensation of something in the room outside of me. An awareness of a red apple is an awareness, a sensation of something that is on the table. It's not inside me, okay? There are other sensations that stay inside of me, okay? For example, pains and itches. A pain or an itch is a sensation. There is a what it is like to be in pain. There is a what it's like to have an itch. And they're a little bit different. Sometimes they're close, but they're usually a little different. And emotions are sensations. There is a that stay in the body. There is a what it is like to feel anger or love or anxiety or something of that sort. So emotions are sensations that are just pure states of awareness. So that's what a sensation is. Now, a sensation cannot be true or false. It can be accurate or inaccurate, but it can't be true or false. If you're looking at an apple that's red and it appears orange to you because of your eyes or the lighting, then your sensation is not accurate, but it would be wrong to say it's false. It would be correct to say it's not an accurate sensation. Okay, the second kind of mental state is a thought. A thought is it is propositional content that can be expressed in a declarative sentence. A thought is the propositional content that can be expressed in a declarative sentence. So, Schnee ist weiß and snow is white both express the same thought through different sentences. The thought is a propositional content or a mental content that is in the mind that can be true or false. So, that's what a thought is. It's just a content that comes to you that can be expressed in a sentence that can be true or false. Thoughts aren't sensations, and sensations aren't thoughts. They're different. The third kind of mental state is a belief. A belief. A belief is an inclination to accept a mental content as true. A belief is an inclination of accepting a mental content as true. And the accepting would be between 51 and 100% certain. So if you have a belief, then you take the content of that belief to be true to some degree or other. It could be a very weak belief, like my belief that the Chiefs will make the playoffs next fall. Is about a 51% belief. I believe it, but I am extremely wavering on it and weak on it. Okay, so a belief is something that I take to, a mental content I take to be true to some degree or other. Now, a belief is not a thought. Thoughts only exist while you're having them, but you have many beliefs that you're not currently entertaining. Your beliefs actually form the structure of your soul along with your desires, but we'll talk about that later. But a belief, you can have beliefs you're not thinking about, and you can have thoughts that you don't believe. So they're different kinds of states. The fourth kind of state is a desire. Is a desire. And this is a felt inclination towards or away from something. It's a felt inclination towards or away from something. So a desire for ice cream and a desire to avoid the dentist are two desires that might perhaps be incompatible in some way or another. So, the most important, the thing that makes the structure of your soul and the way you grow a soul is by giving it more beliefs and desires and creating new desires and beliefs. Those are the key things that form the internal structure of the soul. The fifth kind of mental state is a volition or an exercise of will or freedom. A volition or an exercise of will or volition. I'm going to give you a funny name for it, but it is a trying to bring it about that something happens. It's trying to bring it about that something happens. Now, let me illustrate this trying to bring it about that something happens. Suppose that in the middle of the night, a mad scientist crept into my bedroom and injected my arms with something that caused them to be paralyzed, but I didn't wake up. And unknown to me, my arms didn't move. I get out of the bed in the morning and it's dark and I want to turn the light switch on the wall. So I walk over to the wall and stand there and my body doesn't move. But I do perform an act of consciousness. Namely, I try to bring it about that my arm goes up to turn on the light switch. I endeavor to move my arm. So an act of freedom is sometimes called an endeavoring. I endeavor to raise my arm to turn on the light switch. These are states of consciousness, and they're all different states. Now, there may be more, but I think these five are the fundamental states of consciousness that the human soul possesses. Some animal souls, I think, are not capable of thought or belief, but they only have sensations and perhaps desires. But I think some animals are capable of thought and belief in addition to sensations and so on. Okay, now, why should I believe that these states are not physical? Okay, so now let's get clear on what a physical state is. A physical state is something that can be exhaustively described in the language of chemistry and physics. A physical state is a state that can be exhaustively described in the language of chemistry and physics. So, water's being frozen is something that can be described without appealing to sensations or thoughts or desires or anything like that. There is no what it is like to be a chunk of ice. Okay? There is no what it is like to be an electron. An electron can be exhaustively described using the categories of having a certain size and shape and mass and charge. I don't have to, in order to describe an electron, I don't have to attribute to it sensations or thoughts or beliefs or desires or exercises of volition. Why? Because I take the electron to be a purely material object and all of its internal states to be material. Now, what are the states of the brain? The states of the brain are completely describable using the language of physics and chemistry and biology. So, for example, a state of the brain could be described in terms of the firings of neurons that cross synapses in a region of the brain. Now, a neuron is a cell. It has a nucleus and it has little spindles that come off of it called axons and dendrites. And there is between the axon of one neuron and the dendrite of another neuron a little gap called a synapse. And when electrical potential builds up on one of these, it sparks. And that's called a firing event. The reason antidepressant and anxiety medication are so helpful is that they help restore to the solution between the synapses chemicals that the brain is not producing on its own. Now, you can describe a neuron and a firing event solely in terms of physics and chemistry. You can, for example, talk about the firing of a neuron in terms of calcium and potassium ions, and the movement of negatively charged ions called chlorine ions. And when that movement reaches a certain position, it will cause an electrical potential to bring about a spark. Okay. Now, when you're having pain, there are C fibers firing in your brain. So let's call the C fiber firing state state B. That's a brain state. And let's call the state of feeling a pain M, a mental state. Is M the same thing as B? The answer is no. Why? Because there is a what it is like to be a pain, namely a hurtful sensation. There is no what it's like to be a C fiber firing. The very concept of what it is like is not a concept that plays a role in physics or chemistry or neuroscience. There just is no what it is like that is in the language of neuroscience or any physical science whatsoever. And that's because the notion of what it is like is not a physical concept. There is no what it's like to a neuron, okay? Neurons fire, they're composed of ions, but they're not, there's no hurtfulness to a C fiber firing. My own view is there's a cause-effect relationship, namely the C fiber firing causes the feeling of pain. And that's why you can do deadening of Novocaine and so on that can keep the C fibers from firing so you can't feel pain, but that doesn't prove that the pain's the same thing as the C fiber firing, because there's some things true of pain that aren't true of C fibers and vice versa. Novocaine simply establishes a dependency relationship. If your C fibers are blunted, then you won't feel pain. Thoughts have the property of being true or false, but no brain state has the property of being true or false. Thoughts and beliefs do not have geometrical properties. A thought doesn't have a size, a shape, or a location. Makes no sense to say, is my thought of lunch closer to my left ear than my right ear? Thoughts do not exist in space. They have no location. They don't have a size or a shape. It doesn't make any sense to say, what shape is your thought of the Pythagorean theorem? Or how big is it? Yeah, philosophers have large thoughts, but they don't need neck braces because thoughts don't have geometrical properties. Brain states that are going on while you're having thoughts do have geometrical properties. You can actually look on a monitor and see where the activity of oxygen or electrical sparking is going in what region of the brain. And that region of the brain will have a shape, a size, and a location. It will not be true. It wouldn't make any sense to say, you see that brain state, it's true. No, brain states don't have the property of being true or false, but they have geometrical properties, whereas mental states, like the ones I've shared with you, do not have geometrical properties. One more example is that brain states have structural properties, but mental states don't have structure to them. They're simple. Let me illustrate that. Think of a C fiber firing. It is a complex structural state composed literally of billions of neurons and multiple billions of atoms and molecules in a specific geometrical structure that fires in the right order. Do you understand that? So a C fiber firing is a vast structural state. A pain has no structure to it. It's just a simple quality. It's a simple feeling of hurt. That's what it is. It doesn't have any structure. It doesn't have parts. It isn't built up out of a bunch of parts. It's just it's a quality. It's a quality of hurt. That's what it is. So the first argument that conscious states aren't the same as brain states is that there are properties that conscious states have that brain states don't, and vice versa, so they cannot be the same thing. Now, I'll give you a second argument. You guys doing okay? And that is something called the knowledge argument. Okay. Suppose we lived in the year 10,000 AD, and scientists have now learned everything there is to know about matter. Scientists literally have a God's eye view of matter. They know what matter is in its complete entirety, and they know the brain without any remainder. They have exhaustive knowledge of the brain. Suppose that the leading neuroscientist of that day is named Mary, and she has grasped physical and neuroscientific theory completely. However, she was born blind. All of a sudden, one day she goes into the lab and something happens to her, and for the very first time, she sees colors. Now, the thing with Mary is this. Before this miracle happened, she knew all the physical facts about seeing. She could describe all the physical facts about what happens to the rods and cones in the eye, what sparks down the optic nerve, and what goes on in the brain. She had mastered all of the physical facts. But when she gained sight for the first time, she learned some new facts, didn't she? These would be facts about what it's like to see red, or what it's like to see a square shape, or what it's like to see such and such. Since she knew all the physical facts before her miracle, and since she learned new facts after the miracle, those facts can't be physical facts. Because if they were physical facts, she would have known them before she gained sight. In this case, they must be non-physical facts, that is, mental facts. Another way to put this was put by Thomas Nagel in his article, What It's Like to Be a Bat. This is a crazy title, but it'll make the point. And he said, let's suppose that we have a robot bat, and we know everything about that bat. We know all of its circuitry. We know how it's put together. We know its mass and its size and shape. And we can predict with 100% accuracy where this bat will go if we let it go. In that case, there's nothing that we don't know about the computerized bat. We have exhaustive knowledge of it. But he said, what about a real bat? Suppose we know all of its neural systems, its organs. We can predict with 100% where the bat will go when we release it, but there's one thing we don't have a clue about, and that's what it is like to be a bat. And it is the what it is like that is unavailable to physical theory, because it's not physical, it's consciousness. When scientists observe rapid eye movement, they tell us we're dreaming. How did they know that? They had to wake people up and ask them what was going on when they observed the eye movement. Why did they have to do that? Didn't they have a monitor on the brain measuring the brain waves? Yeah. But they did not have access to the conscious life of the person, so they had to ask them what was going on, because the scientist can know the brain states, but he can't know the mental states. Only the individual herself or himself has access to his own mental states, so they can't be the same thing. So I conclude then that consciousness is physical. So there are two kinds of states: physical states, which are brain states, and mental states. Yes?
You said consciousness is physical.
No, I mean consciousness is immaterial. Excuse me, I'm so sorry. That would make everybody's head explode. Now, the question is, what is it that has consciousness? Is it the brain? In which case, the brain has two kinds of states, physical states and mental states. Or is it a soul that has the mental states? Okay, what is a soul? Let me give you a definition of a soul. A soul is an immaterial substance or thing. A soul is an immaterial substance or thing that contains consciousness and animates the body. The soul is an immaterial substance or thing that contains consciousness and animates or enlivens the body. When a body doesn't have a soul in it, it's no longer a body, it's a corpse, all right? It is the soul that makes the body living. And it's the soul that can, a dog's soul contains the dog's conscious life and makes the dog's body animated, makes it alive. All right. Now, is there such a thing as a soul? And let me give you some arguments for believing that souls are real. Okay? And the first one is this. Human persons are indivisible and cannot come in percentages. The brain and the body are divisible and can come in percentages. Therefore, a human person is not a brain or a body. Okay? The person is either a soul or a brain and the body. Therefore, a person is a soul. Now, I don't mean to be going too quickly here, but here's the point. My body can be divided, and my body can come in percentages. I could lose 30% of my brain and have 70% of a brain. There have actually been operations that have taken 55% of the brain out, and there is a syndrome called Dandy-Walker syndrome, where people have 10% of a brain that's around the edges, and the inside the head is a sac of fluid. But these people have 75% functioning, and so on. So the point is that physical objects can come in percentages. I could divide this table in half and have a 50% of it, or 90% of it. But human persons are all or nothing kinds of things. We do not come in percentages. It doesn't make any sense to say that there's 75% of a person. It does make sense to say there's a person that has 75% functioning, but that's a different point. It's still the person. So persons are all or nothing kinds of things. Now, here's why that's true. Persons are not made of parts. Persons don't have parts. The soul is a partless thing. It is simple, does not contain parts. The body contains parts. That's why it's divisible. Anything made up of parts can be divided. I can't be divided, so I'm not made up of parts. Therefore, I'm a simple thing, a partless thing. So that's the first argument. The second argument is free will. If I were my brain and my central nervous system, my body movements would be entirely determined by the laws of physics and chemistry and inputs that impinged on my organs and my body. All material objects, no matter how complicated they are, from a computer to a rock, behaves in a strictly deterministic way according to natural law in what happens to them. The input, if a rock gets hit in a certain way, according to certain laws, it will move. It doesn't choose to do that. If I am my body and brain, then I am not morally responsible for anything because I have no choice in what I do. All of my actions are determined by my environmental inputs, my brain states, and my genetic makeup. But that's not true. We all know that we act responsibly, at least occasionally, and that we exercise volitional freedom regularly, now and then. If that's true, there's got to be more to me than my body and my brain. I have to be able to transcend the laws of nature and act without being fixed by those laws. I'm like God in that way. I'm able to act into the natural world without being constrained and determined by the natural world. And that can be true only if I am an immaterial thing that's more than just a chunk of matter. So the existence of volitional freedom provides evidence for a soul. The third argument is the idea that a material object does not remain the same if it gains new parts and loses old parts. Okay? A material object does not remain the same if it gains new parts and loses old parts. So suppose I have a pile of five pieces of lumber in the backyard, and they're nailed together. And there's an object there. That object is those five pieces of lumber nailed together. But suppose I come and remove one of those and throw it away and put another board on there and nail it on there. Is it the same object? It's pretty obvious the answer is no, because it's made of, it has a different part. Can't be exact identical to the old object because it's made of different parts. This would become evident, for example, if instead of putting a wood part in replacement, I put a plastic part in there. So a material object, if it loses parts and gains new parts, is not literally the same object, because for physical objects, their identity depends on the parts they have. If I were my body and brain, I would not be the same person from one moment to the next, because I would be constantly undergoing part replacement and change. It would follow that I would have no enduring self. I would literally be, like Buddhism teaches, a series of momentary eye moments replaced by a new eye moment, replaced by a new eye moment, without anything continuing through time, because I'm constantly losing and gaining parts. It would follow from that that I should never be punished for something that happened in the past, because it was not literally I that did it, and I shouldn't fear the dentist because it won't be I that goes to the dentist. There are some advantages of materialism. But I am a thing that literally remains the same through change. It's the same person. I may grow and mature and so on, but it's the same self that will stand before God in judgment as the self that was born in Grandview, Missouri in 1948. Thank you very much. So that's another. Now here's a fourth argument, and this is the possibility of disembodied existence. Everybody will surely agree that even if there's no life after death is at least possible. I don't know of anybody who doesn't think that disembodied life after death is not even possible, like square circles aren't possible. So there is something true of me, namely, I have the property of being possibly disembodied. That's an attribute I have, the attribute of being possibly disembodied. My brain and body aren't possibly disembodiable. They could not exist disembodied. Therefore, they do not have the property of being possibly disembodiable. Since I have that property and my brain and body do not, I cannot be identical to my brain and body. Now, this argument does not assume that there is any such thing as an afterlife or disembodied existence. It only assumes that an afterlife is possible, that there could be an afterlife. And that's enough to show, not that there's an afterlife, but it's enough to show I'm not my body, because it shows that I am possibly disembodiable, but my brain and body aren't. Now, near-death experiences, to me, have shown conclusive evidence of life after death. The literature on near-death experiences, and I've read about 30 books on this, provides overwhelming evidence that people continue to live, they go to heaven or hell, and they return. Now, many of these experiences are fully consistent with biblical Christianity. Some of them have ideas that are not consistent with biblical Christianity. I think those people in most cases still leave their bodies and have experiences, but they interpret them wrongly or see what they want to see. There could be demonic interference involved. That's another issue. But the point is that the evidence for disembodied life after death from near-death experiences is overwhelming. If you want the best book on this that's readable, you want to get a book by J. Stephen Miller, he's a believer, called Near-Death Experiences as Evidence for God and Heaven. near-death experiences as evidence for God and heaven. Okay, now I'm going to stop there. And these are some of the reasons I believe that I'm a soul and not a body. And I've given you things that are true of me that are not true of my brain or body, so I can't be the same thing. So now, let's conclude with some final thoughts. What about neuroscience? All that neuroscience can do is establish a dependency relationship of the mind on the brain or vice versa. It cannot establish what a soul is or whether it is or what consciousness is. Now, let me give you an example about this, and it would mean a lot to me if you'd really listen hard here, because this will be a helpful thing to you if you'll follow me. There are a group of neurons called mirror neurons. And mirror neurons fire when you do something, like pick up a cup or that. They also fire when you observe someone else do the activity. So the same neurons will fire in my brain when I watch you pick up a cup as fire in my brain when I pick up a cup. Now, what they've discovered is that the functioning of mirror neurons is necessary for a feeling of empathy towards other people. If your mirror neurons are damaged, you can't feel empathy for someone else. Now, what follows from this? Okay, are you still with me? Now, let me tell you what empirically equivalent theories are. Let me tell you what empirically equivalent theories are. These are theories that are consistent with the same observational evidence. Okay? So one theory might be that our world stays the same size from one moment to the next. Another theory is that every 10 minutes, everything doubles in size, as does our measuring rods. There would be no observation that you could appeal to decide which of those is true. You'd have to decide which one is true on the basis of other considerations that you could appeal to. Two empirically equivalent theories, then, cannot be decided on the basis of empirical observation. Now, there are three theories that are consistent with this finding about mirror neurons. Here's number one: strict physicalism. On this view, a feeling of empathy is identical to the firing of a mirror neuron. They're the same thing, okay? So when your mirror neurons can't fire, you can't feel empathy because the feeling of empathy is the same thing as the neurons firing in the brain. That would be strict physicalism, okay? The second view is called property dualism. And this is the idea that a feeling of empathy is in no way physical, but it is located in the brain. There's no soul. It is the brain that possesses both physical states and genuinely mental conscious states. So on this view, when a mirror neuron fires, it causes a feeling of empathy in the brain, and they're two radically different events that aren't the same. They stand in a cause-effect relationship, so that if your mirror neurons don't fire, they can't cause a feeling of empathy. That's view two. View three, which is my view, is that the firing of mirror neurons happen in the brain, and the feeling of empathy happens in the self, or the soul, or the ego, okay? And the functioning of the soul depends on the functioning of the brain while we're in the body, all right? So the reason that when mirror neurons not firing keeps me from feeling a feeling of empathy, which is in my soul, is because my soul's functioning depends upon my body working while I'm embodied. Now, all three of those theories are consistent with the neurological evidence. The neurological evidence cannot decide which of those three theories is true. Thus, science and the is utterly unable to address these questions. Now, let me give you two illustrations that may help you. It's become clear to a number of us that memories do not exist in the brain. The world's leading expert on memory, a psychologist at UC Santa Barbara, came to lecture to us at Biola, and he said, "I have no idea what it means to say a memory's in the brain. The whole idea is crazy." And this is obvious, because if you could get down to the size of an atom, you would see the brain the way it really is. Because when you look at it in the skull, it looks like it's a solid object that's continuous and so on. But when you really look at it the way it really is, it's like a galaxy. It's composed of gazillions of little particles that are thousands of miles away from one another at that level of size. It's basically empty space. Where would a memory be put? Is it supposed to be spread out in the empty space between two atoms? Is it supposed to, memories aren't in your brain. What is in the brain? Neural grooves that have to be activated before you can retrieve a memory. Illustration. You have a CD. Is there music in that CD? The answer is no. How do you know? Hold it up to your ear. You can't hear any music. There's no music in the CD. What is in the CD are grooves of a certain kind. If the CD isn't damaged and you have the right retrieval system, activating those grooves will produce music in another object called a speaker. Memories aren't in the brain. What are in the brain are grooves. If the grooves aren't damaged and the right retrieval system, the soul or the self, is searching for a memory, then that act will trigger a groove in the brain that will bring the memory back that exists in the mind or the soul. The memory doesn't exist in the brain, it's the groove that exists in the brain. But while you're in the body, you can't access the memory unless the groove is okay and is activated. Now, if you see the point, another example is that if I'm in a car and strapped into the seat, in the front seat, my ability to move around town is going to depend on the car working. If the car breaks down and it will only turn right, that will limit my ability to move, but that doesn't prove I'm the car. It's consistent with that evidence that I'm the driver of the car. Same with embodiment. While I'm in the body, if the car is broken down, if my eyes are out, I can't see. If my brain doesn't work, I can't think. But that doesn't prove that my eyes see or my brain thinks. It just proves that I, while I'm in the car, use my eyes to see and use my brain to think, such that if they're damaged, I can't use them. Now, if I could get out of the car, I'd be okay. And that's why when people die, their memories go with them, because they never were in the brain in the first place. The only thing that was in the brain was neural grooves that need to be activated before the retrieval system can get the memory while you're in the body. But when you're not in the body, all bets are off. Okay, shoot. Animal souls are so simple. Let me put it to you like this. Your soul has faculties in it. And think of a faculty as a compartment. Like a chest of drawers has several drawers, and in each drawer there are the same thing. Socks in this drawer, t-shirts in this drawer, and so on. Your soul has different faculties, like compartments, and in each faculty there are the same things. So one of the faculties of the soul is the mind, and that's a drawer in the chest of drawers. What's in that drawer are thoughts and beliefs and the ability to reason. The faculty of the five senses are in the soul, and what is in each one of those compartments is the ability to see or smell. That would be a different compartment. The faculty of emotion contains all the abilities you have to feel this and that or the other. The faculty of will is a different compartment, and it contains your abilities to choose. And in my view, there is a spirit that's different than the soul. Could be wrong about it. But I take the faculty of spirit to be a compartment of the human soul that has the powers of being aware of demons and angels and God, directly aware of him. So the point is that the human soul contains a whole bunch of compartments that are all faculties of the soul that contain different abilities, thought, feeling, and volition. Animal souls don't have spirits. Some of them don't have minds. I think higher animal souls have minds. They can think rudimentary. They can't think about their thinking. Augustine, talking about the animal soul, pointed out that the human soul not only thinks, but thinks about its thinking. But animals never give any evidence that they're thinking about their thinking. Like they're sitting around thinking, I wonder if I can improve my thinking. Or I wonder which one of my thoughts are true. Animals have desires, but they don't have desires to have desires, so they can't set New Year's resolutions. Animals have beliefs, but they don't have beliefs about their beliefs. Okay. So the animal soul depends on the animal, and it's simple, and only the human soul is made in God's image. All right, I think I've said enough to make everybody mad at me. So let's have a little time of question, and then I'll go. Seven minutes or 10. All right, ladies and gentlemen. Yes.
Can you comment on Ben Carson's view on homosexuality?
I don't know his view.
He just said it's a choice.
Well, yeah, I think there are predispositions that are not determinative. And I think that there is no evidence that a predisposition to anger or murder or anxiety. I have a genetic predisposition towards a general anxiety disorder, and there are things I can do to control that. So we all have predispositions to things, but I do think at the end of the day, it is a choice. And I don't think that there can be any scientific evidence to the contrary. And the reason is because science does not have the concept of a volitional action or an intentional action. That is not a concept that the hard sciences can use. All they can do is measure certain things that happen in the brain with certain behaviors, but they can't tell whether something is a volitional choice or not. Yes, sir.
Would you elaborate a little bit more about the spirit part of ourself here? Because that seems to be very important.
About what?
Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that the spirit is a compartment of the soul that is able to receive new life. It is able to be aware of God's presence and of the unseen world. And I think the ability to be aware of beings in that world is due to the fact that we have a faculty of spiritual perception, and that's the spirit. Now, all these faculties work with each other and against each other. So if I think a certain way, I can't feel certain things. If I feel a certain way, I can't entertain certain thoughts. So there's a huge conglomeration. But that's about all I can say about the faculty of spirit. I do believe there is one, and I do think it's important, but I don't have much else to say about it.
Real quick, what do you think about the argument that they're different states, the physical and the conscious states are different because, like someone who walks over hot coals, although everything's happening the same in their brain, as far as I understand, they're not feeling or they're choosing not to feel the sensation of pain in that moment. Like if I was walking on the hot coals, I certainly would.
Yes.
Is that a good argument or?
Yeah, on the assumption that what's happening in the brain is the same. If that assumption is true, then that's a good argument because what it shows is that my mental will to block out pain is a state that is not a state of my brain because my brain is in the same state whether I don't know the answer to it, but if that assumption is correct, yes, that would be a good argument. I just don't know if your assumption's correct.
Professor, how does the idea of someone being born again fit into your business here?
Yeah.
And what's the difference between the soul of someone who's born again and someone who's not?
Okay. Literally, when a person is born again, a metaphysical change actually takes place in that person. And that the spirit of an unregenerate person is deadened. That means it is inoperable except for certain parts of it where there can still be an awareness of a supreme being, but there are deadened parts of that spirit. Now, what happens, in my view, is that in regeneration, a seed of life is planted in the spirit, and what is a seed? It is the power to organize reality according to its nature. That's what a seed is. So a corn seed is the power to organize soil and other things in its environment according to its nature. Namely, it will develop a corn stalk. A tomato seed is the power to take in things from the environment and organize it according to its nature. This seed has the power to take the other faculties and organize them according to the nature of the kingdom of God if those faculties don't resist. And if there is the proper teaching and practices and exercises, that seed will begin to infiltrate the rest and make it different. It's a good question.
You brought up the spirit.
The what?
So you brought up the spirit. How yes. Our conscience, we have the spirit in us.
I don't think our spirit is our conscience.
Okay.
But
there's a difference.
I believe there is.
So the question I have is about the Holy Spirit. So as believers, we have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside us. How do you know the difference between the spirit, the Holy Spirit, and the soul? How do you define those three?
Well, the Holy Spirit is an omniscient being that existed long before I did and is omnipresent and is divine. My spirit is a puny little faculty of my little soul. And if I were to go extinct, if God were to snuff me out of existence, my spirit would cease to exist, but the Holy Spirit would still be real. So the Holy Spirit is divine. He's separate from me. We should never talk about Christian union with God, which is an important idea in the spiritual formation literature. We ought never to talk about that metaphysically, as though we literally become one with God, because that's pantheism. We should talk about it relationally. To become one with God means that we become so close that there's a deep intimacy between the two of us, but not metaphysically, because if that's the case, to become one with God is for me to go out of existence like a drop of water goes into the ocean and for me to be absorbed in God's being, and that's not Christianity. That, I don't know what else to say than that. Thank you, though, for that. I don't know. Listen, this was different. I recognize that. And I took a risk hoping that you would enjoy some things that maybe were a little different. And I just hope that this has helped you in some level. Okay. I see that hand, sir.
I see that hand. Has there been any thinking to the interface of how the brain activates the soul or connects to it?
Goes both ways. Thank God, because neuroplasticity is the idea that you can change your brain structure by changing the way you think. So by thinking the proper things over and over again, you can regroove your tendency toward anxiety and fear and obsessive-compulsive behavior and literally change the shape of your brain by changing your thinking. They've demonstrated this through brain scans. So the brain can affect the mind and the mind affect the brain. Now, the question is, how does this happen? That question can mean one of two things. The first thing, the question of how does this interaction happen, can mean the question, how in the heck can that happen because they're so different? This is impossible. If that's the question, it's an expression of skepticism, and I would say that the skepticism presupposes that before A can act on B, A's got to be like B. But I don't know why I should believe that. Can you give me an argument for why A has to be like B before A can act on B? No, but I find it perfectly conceivable that God could part the Red Sea, and they're completely unlike. He's a spirit, it's matter. So that's the skeptical question. If the question is, how does this happen? The question is a mistaken one because, and here's why, because the question, how does A, turning on my key, cause B, the engine, to start, is a request to describe an intervening mechanism between A and B that A accomplishes its action on B through this intervening mechanism. So a how question is legitimate if there's an intervening mechanism between A and B. But there is no intervening mechanism between the mind and the body or brain. The action is basic and immediate. It doesn't go by way of any intervening mechanism. So the question, how does the mind act on the brain, is like the question, who made God? You can't ask the question, who made God, because God is the first cause and is a basic fundamental being. You can't ask the question, how does the mind act on the brain, because it's fundamental and primitive. There is no further question to be asked. So that would be my answer.
Dr. Moreland, how about one last question? Okay. All right, and then we'll wrap this up right here.
How do we, with all this in mind, consider the great commandment of loving the Lord our God with all our soul, mind, heart, strength?
Well, I have taken that passage to be using legitimately different faculties as, I think the figure is called a hendiadys. That's the figure of speech. And a hendiadys would be like saying, I waited night and day for you to show up. And the phrase night and day is contrasting to emphasize the fullness or how much I waited for you. So by using these different faculties, really what is being said is that we should love God with every single thing we have. And that's not just one part of me. If I'm loving him with one part and not the others, there's a problem. That's what I think the text is getting at. Thank you very much.
Let's thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Man, I think the way to say that is we've been schooled. Amen. That has been really good. That was a whole semester worth of philosophy, theology, all crammed into one morning. Guys, it has been a blessing to have you here. Dr. Moreland will be speaking in our chapel tomorrow morning at 9:30 for our students. There's about 1,000 chairs set up in here for chapel, but you are welcome. Should you know of a young person you'd like to encourage, maybe they are off school or want to skip school in the morning, or someone who can make it over, you're welcome yourself. There'll be a different topic this tomorrow morning that Dr. Moreland will be sharing on, and we want you to know you're welcome. Again, lunch here if you want to. If you want to check out the cafe, make sure you tell them you're with the pastor's seminar, okay? And it should be $7.48, something like that. And get your 2 cents when you walk out. Quick comment about two displays. The Western Seminary over there, we are great partners with them right across the freeway. We appreciate who they are, what they're doing, so much so that we have faculty that are teaching in both locations at times. Please stop by and see what they've got going on. We've got some materials for William Jessup University on the other table here to the left as you head out the doors. Take some items with you if you would like. We'd love to have you see some of the new programs that John didn't even get a chance to mention to you. You know, we now have a kinesiology program, sports medicine, body movement. We have a computer science program starting up next fall. We just continue to add more and more programs, and it's tough peddling to keep up with his ideas and his vision, but it's going really well. We'd love to have you take some of the materials for that. One last comment. If you've not had a tour of this place, I'd love to treat you personally. Just sometime, you shoot me an email. Say, hey, Jim, I've never been there really except for the seminars. I've not seen what the place looks like. I can't stick around for lunch today. shoot me an email. I'd love to show you the place. And I won't pass an offering plate in front of you. I won't pressure you about partnership. I want to show you this place so you know better how to share with people what's happening at William Jessup University. You can bring your whole staff if you want. We can do a little lunch in one of the private dining rooms in the cafe. You'll enjoy the lunch here, and I think you'd enjoy the experience. Bryce Jessup, where are you at? My dad, come on up here, man. I was going to have Dr. David Timms. I guess that means your second string. Sorry about this, brother. Our director, our chief Bible and theology professor, head of our Bible and theology department, Dr. David Timms, had to be off campus, and I was going to have him share in a prayer and tell you a little bit about a new master's in leadership coming. We're starting up a master's in leadership next spring. We hoped we'd be starting sooner, but we're still working out to make sure it's a quality program, primarily online, and it's going to be a really good program. So I was going to have him tell you a little bit about that. There is some paperwork on the back table as you leave if you'd like to grab it. And I was going to have him close in a prayer, but actually this guy knows how to pray, so I'm going to have him do it. This is my father, President Emeritus. He retired in 2010, but he still hangs out now. He's got a little office next to me in the development office, and he bugs me a lot, but I like him. So here you go, brother. Pray us out.
It goes both ways.
Would you stand with us?
I don't know what your takeaway is from today, but I, at my age, have memory issues, and I just found out it's not my memory, it's grooves in my brain. I've got to refocus my prayers on how to deepen those grooves so that that memory can connect. Let's pray. Father, truth was once for all delivered unto the saints, but our understanding of it goes on and on. Help us to be open to understanding in a deeper way the truth that you've given to us so that we can present that message in ways that will have an audience and will be accepted. And so, Lord, give us a deeper understanding of the world that you created and of ourselves and of the truth that you gave to us, that we might base it, Father, on knowledge and we might communicate it to a generation that so desperately needs you. Thank you for our time together, for each of these who hold up truth in this community. Continue to move us forward, for it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
God bless you all. Have a great day.